Well, good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Merry Christmas. It's kind of like right, I think it's 9:30 right now, so.
And you're on time.
Yeah, it's a strange thing. We're having, I'm having another crisis morning. Could not get any internet capability, so we're recording. So for those folks who are streaming live, they'll catch it later. And that's an unfortunate thing, but there we go. All right, we're going to pray. And we are going to sing some songs. We're going to do a lot of singing. All right, let's pray. Lord Jesus, we are very, very glad to be here. Frustrations aside, and difficulties aside, it's always a problem, Lord, when I want to make something beautiful for you, when I want to do something right for you, and it doesn't work out. I think that's probably how Joseph felt, how Mary felt, how shepherds felt. Want to do something big and beautiful and things fall apart. We entrust our service to you, Lord Jesus. We entrust the music to you. We pray your blessing on Daryl, on Rebecca, on me, on all the readers. We pray that you will speak to our hearts and our minds today, that your life and your light will shine through our brokenness. We are broken people. We're doing the best we can to get through each day. And the only way we make it is because of your love. And today is the Love Sunday, the Sunday of love. We had hope, and we had peace, and we had joy, and this is the Sunday of love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. The cosmos, all creation. Whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. It's all about love, Lord Jesus. Help us worship you well. In Jesus' name, amen. On this Love Sunday, we're going to start. You can stand with me and sing this tune. The love of God.
Down.
What I want to do is kind of explain what's going to happen here. In just a couple of minutes, I'm going to have Shiloh come up and read and light our final candle on the Advent wreath. And then I'm going to hand it to Daryl, and he's going to lead us in some worship Christmas songs. And then in the midst of that, we have some readings as well. And those readings are going to happen. The people doing those readings are going to do them from their seat. They're going to have the microphone here. And that allows us to just all be focused on what's being said, and it eliminates a lot of up and down, all of those kind of things. A couple of things that I want to make you aware of announcement-wise. Remember all of the giving options that are going on. Of course, it's the end of the year, and we want to make ends meet for the First Baptist Church budget. Remember that. Remember the Shady Ladies tree in the back. And there are so many gifts back there that are ultimately going to go to Doug and Cora Person, who are assisting Somali immigrants in their life in Seattle. So that is still an opportunity for you to give. And then, of course, our Advent conspiracy giving, which the four themes of Advent conspiracy: worship fully, spend less, give more, love all. This is the Love Sunday. We ultimately are taking up, we are seeking gifts that will go to Living Water International. And you know, we have a long history with them, and have been glad to assist in providing wells all over the world for communities and schools and people who are followers of Jesus and people who aren't followers of Jesus, all done in the name of Jesus. So where there's a well, there's healthy water. Where there's healthy water, people can, they don't have to walk miles to get the water they need. They aren't sick. Kids can go to school. Women can engage in businesses for their families. It's a good, good thing all the way around. And with Living Water always comes the presentation of the gospel, as well as training and hygiene and all the things that are necessary to maintain them. So Living Water International. You can write a check. You can put that, just note it, write it to First Baptist Church, note it for Living Water International. And you can do that on the website. I looked, and you can designate a gift via the giving on the website. So.
Can I skip?
Yes.
Portion of
it. Oh, that's right. Yes, of course. I do want to mention that some of Daryl's CDs are in the back, his piano music, and a portion of that, whatever's given toward that, and it's a give what you can kind of thing, and whatever's given toward that, some of that is going to go to Living Water. So, okay. I think that covers what I need to cover. So Shiloh, would you... I'm sorry, what? Yes.
This is the revelation of God's love for us, that God sent his only Son into the world that we might have life through him. Love consists in this: it is not we who love God, but God who loves us and sent his Son to expiate our sins. 1 John chapter 4, 9 through 10. It is time to light the candle of love, the candle that symbolizes God's love for the world in giving his only Son to be our Savior. It is said that the Father of God, of Jesus, loves men and women, not for what he finds in them, not because men and women are good that he loves them, nor only good men and women that he loves. It is because he is so unutterably good that he loves all persons, good and evil. He loves the loveless, the unloving, and the unlovable. He does not detect what is continual, appealing, attractive, and respond to it with his favor. In fact, he does not respond at all. The Father of Jesus is a source. He acts. He does not react. He initiates love. And on that dark night so long ago, he initiated a love that was willing to set aside heavenly glories, willing to submit itself to becoming a human being. And not even a human being of great standing, but one of low birth and poor circumstances, wrapped in rags, sleeping in a cattle trough.
Favorite and treasured carols depicting in response to what was just read is O Come Emmanuel. It is said that it is one of the favorites, and I'm going to tell you why. Because in the words, I don't know if Shiloh, you can put those words up now, but the words, O Come Emmanuel, ransomed captive Israel, who mourns in lonely exile. Most of you know that there are major and minor chords. Minor chords are sad, mournful, gloomy, dark. And then there's the major chord. Hopeful, bright. This song contains both minor and major. When we come to the rejoice, rejoice! It's major because it's the answer to the doom and the gloom and the mourning. So let's sing this with that understanding.
O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, who mourns in lonely exile here, unto the Son.
Rejoice. Reverend Gaspar, the treasure master, called so because I comprehend the hidden language of the stars, a very great treasure indeed. I have spent out my life here in Susa, studying the ancient star text by day, watching the ancient star dance by night. I have seen their ways, charted their courses, and can anticipate the movement of the wandering stars from day to week to month. So when Jupiter moved into Pisces, I began to make plans. When Saturn crept into alignment, I readied my servants and candles. "Where do you go?" asked my wife, and I was astonished. After all these years of measuring the stars with me, did she still comprehend so little? "Jove, the king of the gods, has joined with Saturn, Palestine in the sky. They burn brightly in the house of David." "Pisces," I elaborated, when she did not seem to understand. "And so," she asked, "it is a dawn rising in the east, thus portending a birth, the birth of a king from the house of David, the king of the Jews." "Not the Jews," my wife rolled her eyes. "They are so selfish. They serve only one God and claim he is the only one worth serving. All others, they say, are his servants at best, or more likely, nothing more than bits of wood and stone." "All the more reason to go see." "He speaks only to the Jews." "No, he has spoken to me as well, for he has left his footprints among the stars." She grumbled, and I packed, and on the day all was in readiness, a caravan from Persepolis arrived in the city. They too were treasure masters, and we joined our numbers together for strength and company along the way. Thus we followed the stars' indication and traveled the long miles to Jerusalem. When we arrived, we made straight for the magnificent palace behind the city wall, intending to offer homage and gifts to the infant king. But no one there seemed to know of the birth. Herod, the one who sat upon the throne, had no new sons. His wise men consulted ancient texts and revealed that a promised king was to be born in Bethlehem. So we bade them a ready farewell, for though we had been feasted and honored amidst grandeur and luxury, none of us liked the look of the man Herod. Dusk was just drawing its shadowed fingers on the sky when we left the palace. And as we looked up, lo, a new light appeared, moving across the heavens from north to south toward Bethlehem, where we had been directed. What could we do but follow? That same night we arrived in the town, still following the wonderful star, which stopped finally above a small dwelling. And there we found a woman and a man. Stars spilling its radiance over his head. We described to them how the Hebrew God had revealed to us, who could read the language, a clear invitation to the birth of their wonderful child. We left our gifts, treasure we had brought to honor the king, gold, frankincense, myrrh. But we treasure masters returned home with greater treasure than we brought. We had seen the future king. And we knew he was not just for the Jews, but for us as well. For God had proclaimed his coming to us across the vastness of the night sky.
Many thousands of years ago, this music was penned, these words were penned. When we sing it, it's as if it's true now, and it was true then. We celebrate Jesus, born of the Father's love.
Herod, king of the Jews. I have ruled here in Judea for 35 years, and I have done well by my people. I have rebuilt the temple, restored it to its former glory. Some say even surpassed what it was in Solomon's day. But not just the temple. I have turned Jerusalem into a city of luxury and splendor, recreated it as a Roman city. Under my influence, Jerusalem has become a metropolis, spilling over with reception halls, gardens, baths, swimming pools, and industrial facilities. And beyond Jerusalem, I have raised my hand, building two palaces on Masada, single-handedly raising the great maritime city of Caesarea out of the sand and the sea. I have built three palaces, a theater, and a race course in the garden city of Jericho. And Herodium, my Herodium, palace, fortress, mausoleum, the most spectacular of my accomplishments. And though I am the king of the Jews, I rule over many who do not share the ancient faith, and I have striven to be king for them as well. I have turned my eyes beyond Judea and built in Antioch, Damascus, Sidon, and Tyre. In the non-Jewish cities of my realm, I have constructed temples for the people to satisfy their longings for other gods. I was responsible for refounding the Olympic Games in Greece. My fame has justly spread far to the corners of the earth. So, of course, the visiting sages came to see me. They are not the first dignitaries to come and be awed by the magnificence I have created around me. I greeted them with ceremony and honor, feasted them luxuriously, and showed them the splendors of my palace. And then they wanted to know where they could find the king of the Jews. I am the king of the Jews. No, no, they insisted, the new king, the one just born. We have seen his star rising out of the east. I turned to my advisors, to the scribes, who study the ancient texts and decipher the riddles of the prophets. Messiah, they whispered to me, the scion of the house of David, daily expected by the superstitious, pathetic masses of Jerusalem. And then they began to argue the details of his reign. Would he be a warrior, a servant, a great conqueror, or a martyr? Never mind, I said, over the ridiculous bickering. Where is he to be born? Bethlehem. And this I told the sages and sent them on their way with instructions to return and provide me with his direction so that I too might go and offer him homage. And when they were gone, I made other plans to assure that my reign would continue. For I am the king of the Jews and a very good king. My reign has been stable and prosperous. And if some say despotic and ruthless, I would like to know how they would deal with the traitors who plot against them. Some of my advisors might raise their brows, but really, if I did not spare the lives of my own sons for the sake of my rule, why would I falter over the sons of some peasant women? It is my right to do as I see best, and it is best that the child die for my sake. After all, I am the king of the Jews.
Thank you. It came to us out of the silence of the night sky. The ground shook, and I felt the impact all the way to my bones, even though there was no sound. It arrived not gradually, not as from a distance, but instantly. It was there. The fire we had lit that seemed so bright and warm a moment before was now like a candle to the midday sun in the cataract of light that poured down on us from above. Then we were spoken to in a voice unlike any voice I had ever heard before, if I had actually heard it at all. I heard it with my blood and my teeth and my bowels. And though my muscles had turned to sand and I covered the ground like dew, the light told me not to be afraid, to sit up and take notice. And I did, because I could not do otherwise. A baby had been born in Bethlehem, in a stable outside a home, and we should rejoice because it was Messiah, the long-awaited King. Just as I was beginning to grow accustomed to the light and the voice and the presence, it grew with the same shuddering impact, but multiplied by the thousands. More light arrived, although we could not have imagined that there was such a thing as more. More light and more voice, more presence. And it sang and sang until every part of me, down to my fingernails, sang with it. Glory to God in the highest. Peace and unending love to all who huddle in the dark fields of the earth. And then it was gone. All the light and all the voice. And the breeze rustled once more around the warm glow of our fire. The sheep slept or chewed contentedly, never even blinking at the magnificence. We stared around at one another, afraid even to ask if the one next to us had seen and heard it as well. But we knew, and without a word, we stood and smothered the fire and left the sheep and hurried into Bethlehem. Our feet took us right to the stable and the manger and the red-faced baby squalling lustily until its mother picked him up and put him to her breast. She was tired but pleased with her night's work, and like every mother, inordinately proud of her creation. I looked at the shriveled little thing and wondered that this was the heir to David's throne, a new king, the mighty one who would lead Israel out of its present darkness and into light. And then I remembered the light in the field and the voice and the presence, and I wondered no more.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains and mountains in reply, echoing the joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Say that with me, will you? Gloria in excelsis Deo. Glory to God in the highest.
Angels.
About 30 years ago, I was at the cabin on Discovery Bay, and we were taking a break, and I was thinking of the Advent song, or the Advent message, in one word, which is Emmanuel. And we sing it often, O come, Emmanuel, we sang that. And the essence of the word is God with us, and that he will reign, and his kingdom has no end, in Isaiah. So I sat with my guitar in the key of D, and just started singing, and I said, Carlene, come and sing with me. You sing this echo part, and out came the song that became a kind of a staple for our church at that time. It's called Emmanuel.
Joseph is my cousin, my mother's sister's son, and you'll never find a better man. A hard worker, steady, down to earth, not a wild zealot with fire in his eyes, nor a poet lost in imagination. A good man, a good husband. Which is why we all felt so sorry for him, at least at first. Of course, he wouldn't be the first man to bring home a bride breeding another man's babe, but he deserved better. He really did. When Mary, his fiance, came back from an extended visit in Ain Karim, it was already becoming evident that things were not as they should be, if you know what I mean. I'll give her this. She didn't hesitate or waste any time. Although from the hang of her gown, there was precious little to waste. She bypassed her father's house and went straight to Joseph and took him aside for a little chat. Then he went home. Joseph went into his shop and didn't come out for 3 days. We could hear a lot of sighing and hammering and banging and muttering, lots of muttering. Nobody much wanted to go in and disturb him. Then, after the third night, he came out.
And while none of us expected grand drama and tumult in the town square, neither did we expect what actually happened. He went to her father's house and got her and brought her back to his own house as his wife. No fuss, no bother, no grand statements of forgiveness or cautions against future infidelity. And she came along with her head up, no shame or embarrassment on her face, no remorse. And when someone, his brother, I believe, finally ventured to ask him what had happened, what was going on, he told a tale. Oh, such a tale about angels and promises and dreams and David's lineage and a miraculous son. Crazy talk. Except it was Joseph. I tell you, he is not a fanciful man. And while there's plenty of man who will deceive himself for the sake of tranquility in his home, Joseph has never struck me as the type. He believed what he said about God's son and the hope of Israel. And then there was the census. And they kept waiting, putting it off, hoping the baby would be born first until it was almost too late and they had to make the trip in the last month. I was already in Bethlehem, had been there for several weeks. I tell you, the Romans have nothing but interminable with their paperwork. They got to Bethlehem, checked in with the officials, and then there was no place to stay. I mean, they came to our house, but it was so full, people were spilling over the threshold. They could have curled up in a corner. That's what everyone else was doing. But Mary's pains, predictably, had begun. There was no room in the house for all the hustle and fuss of childbirth. So they went out back to the stable, a little cave in the hillside there. It was warm enough and dry, a lot quieter than it was in the house. And I went, too, because Joseph's my cousin, and I'd midwifed a lot of births back in Nazareth. Somebody had to help the poor girl. She had no idea what she was doing. She was good, though, did what I said, pushed when I told her to, worked real hard without crying or screaming or carrying on. Once more, I said, hold her up, Joseph, help her push. And in a rush of blood and water, the baby slipped into my hands, into the world. I swung him once to get the fluid from his lungs, and he gasped and cried and turned purple with rage. And while Mary lay back in the straw, exhausted but happy, and Joseph brushed her hair back from her eyes and murmured how proud he was, I held that baby close and looked into his perfect face. And suddenly I remembered Joseph's story of the angel and the promise. And though it was just a baby with 10 fingers and 10 toes, still white from the womb, there was a change in the air like the prelude to lightning. And for a moment I thought I heard music echoing out of the hills. And when the baby opened its eyes and looked at me in that funny, nearsighted way babies do, for a moment, I thought I saw a vastness and love like I had never imagined. And for that moment, it seemed possible that I cradled in my arms the Son of God.
Oh,
This is what we celebrate. And as I heard this morning on somebody else's church service, as we consider the first Advent, one of the things that we always want to remember is that it isn't just looking backward to some pleasant memory in the past that makes us happy. It's also looking forward, because that's what Advent is. Advent is coming. The one who came the first time is going to come a second time, and all the world will be put right when he comes. That's what we're thinking about. That's what we're celebrating. So as you gather with your families, as you're singing and playing, as you're opening gifts, as you're doing Christmas stockings, remember that there's a bigger, bigger thing behind all of this. It is that Jesus is Lord, and it's that God so loved the world that he gave his son for us. Let's pray, and then we'll close. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for Daryl and his skill, his playing, his leading. We thank you for all the voices of Christmas this morning. We thank you for the telling of the story, which is critical to our understanding. We have heard the gospel this morning. We thank you for the people who are here gathered who love each other and like to be together to celebrate you. Help us to remember there's another coming. And we want to be faithful, faithful to you to the end. Help us to be that, Lord. Help us to be kind. Help us to be compassionate. Help us to be forgiving, the way you have forgiven us in Jesus Christ. Especially at holiday times when we have family around, we need to remember those kind, compassionate, forgiving. Help us, Lord. Walk with us through today, walk with us through tonight, and all through tomorrow. We pray this in Jesus' name.